The Duellist. Book 1. By Charles Churchill. The clock struck 12, over half the globe. Darkness had spread her pitchy robe. Morpheus, his feet with velvet shod, treading as if in fear he trod, gentle as dews at eventide, distilled his poppies far and wide. Ambition, who, when waking, dreams of mighty but fantastic schemes, who, when asleep, never knows that rest with which the humbler soul is blessed, was building castles in the air, goodly to look upon, and fair, but on a bad foundation laid, doomed at return of morn to fade. Pale study, by the taper's light, wearing away the watch of night, sat reading, but, with overcharged head, remembered nothing that he read. Starving midst plenty, with a face which might the court of famine grace, ragged and filthy to behold, grey avarice nodded over his gold. Jealousy, his quick eye half closed, with watchings worn, reluctant dozed, and, mean distrust not quite forgot, slumbered as if he slumbered not. Stretched at his length on the bare ground, his hardy offspring sleeping round, snored restless labour, by his side, lay health, a coarse but comely bride. Virtue, without the doctor's aid, in the soft arms of sleep was laid, whilst vice, within the guilty breast, could not be physicked into rest. Thou bloody man! Whose ruffian knife is drawn against thy neighbour's life, and never scruples to descend into the bosom of a friend, a firm, fast friend, by vice allied, and to thy secret service tied, in whom 10 murders breed no awe, if properly secured from law, thou man of lust! Whom passion fires to foulest deeds, whose hot desires over honest bars with ease make way, whilst idiot beauty falls a prey, and to indulge thy brutal flame, a Lucrece must be brought to shame, who dost, a brave, bold sinner, bear rank incest to the open air, and rapes, full-blown upon thy crown, enough to weigh a nation down, thou similar of lust. Vain man, whose restless thoughts still form the plan of guilt, which, withered to the root, thy lifeless nerves can't execute, whilst in thy marrowless, dry bones, desire without enjoyment groans, thou perjured wretch! Whom fossored clothes, even like a garment, who with oaths dost trifle, as with brokers, meant to serve thy every vile intent, in the day's broad and searching eye, making God witness to a lie, blaspheming heaven and earth for pelf, and hanging friends to save thyself, thou son of chance! Whose glorious soul, on the four aces doomed to roll, was never yet with honour caught, nor on poor virtue lost one thought, who dost thy wife, thy children set, thy all, upon a single bet, risking the desperate stake to try, here and hereafter on a die, who, thy own private fortune lost, dost game on at thy country's cost, and, grown expert in sharping rules, first fooled thyself, now preys on fools, thou noble gamester! Whose high place gives too much credit to disgrace, who, with the motion of a die, dost make a mighty island fly, the sums, I mean, of good French gold, for which a mighty island sold. Who dost betray intelligence, abuse the dearest confidence, and, private fortune to create, most falsely play the game of state, who dost within the alley sport, sums which might beggar a whole court, and make us bankrupts all, if care, with good Earl Talbot, was not there, thou daring infidel. Whom pride and sin have drawn from reason's side, who, fearing his avengeful rod, dost wish not to believe a God, whose hope is founded on a plan, which should distract the soul of man, and make him curse his abject birth, whose hope is, once returned to earth, there to lie down, for worms a feast, to rot and perish like a beast, who dost, of punishment afraid, and by thy crimes a coward made, to every generous soul a curse, than hell and all her torments worse, when crawling to thy latter end, call on destruction as a friend, choosing to crumble into dust, rather than rise, though rise you must, thou hypocrite! Who dost profane, and take the patriot's name in vain, then most thy country's foe, when most of love and loyalty you boast, who, for the love of filthy gold, thy friend, thy king, thy goddess sold, and, mocking the just claim of hell, were bidders found, thyself wouldst sell, ye villains! Of whatever name, whatever rank, to whom the claim of hell is certain, on whose lids that worm, which never dies, forbids sweet sleep to fall, come, and behold, whilst envy makes your blood run cold, behold, by pitiless conscience led, so justice wills, that holy bed, where peace her full dominion keeps, and innocence with Holland sleeps. Bid terror, posting on the wind, affray the spirits of mankind, bid earthquakes, heaving for a vent, rive their concealing continent, and, forcing an untimely birth, through the vast bowels of the earth, endeavor, in her monstrous womb, at once all nature to entomb, bid all that's horrible and dire, all that man hates and fears, conspire, to make night hideous as they can, still is thy sleep, thou virtuous man. Pure as the thoughts which in thy breast inhabit, and ensure thy rest, still shall thy Eyecliff, taught, though late, thy friendly justice in his fate, turn to a guardian angel, spread sweet dreams of comfort round thy head. Dark was the night, by fate decreed, for the contrivance of a deed, more black than common, which might make this land from her foundations shake, might tear up freedom by the root, destroy a Wilkes, and fix a Butte. Deep horror held her wide domain, the sky in sullen drops of rain, forewept the morn, and through the air, which, opening, laid its bosom bare, loud thunders rolled, and lightning streamed, the owl at freedom's window screamed, the screech owl, prophet dire, whose breath brings sickness, and whose note is death, the churchyard teemed, and from the tomb, all sad and silent, through the gloom, the ghosts of men, in former times, whose public virtues were their crimes. Indignant stalked, sorrow and rage, blanked their pale cheeks, in his own age, the prop of freedom, Hamden there, felt after death the generous care, Sidney by grief from heaven was kept, and for his brother patriot wept, all friends of liberty, when fate, prepared to shorten Wilkes's date, heaved, deeply hurt, the heartfelt groan, and knew that wound to be their own. Hail, liberty! A glorious word, in other countries scarcely heard, or heard but as a thing of course, without, or energy, or force, here felt, enjoyed, adored, she springs, far, far beyond the reach of kings, fresh blooming from our mother earth, with pride and joy she owns her birth, derived from us, and in return, bids in our breasts her genius burn, bids us with all those blessings live, which liberty alone can give, or nobly with that spirit die, which makes death more than victory. Hail, those old patriots! On whose tongue, persuasion in the Senate hung, whilst they the sacred cause maintained. Hail, those old chiefs! To honor trained, who spread, when other methods failed, war's bloody banner, and prevailed. Shall men like these unmentioned sleep, promiscuous with the common heap, and, gratitude forbid the crime, be carried down the stream of time, in shoals, unnoticed and forgot, on Lethe's stream, like flags, to rot? No, they shall live, and each fair name, recorded in the book of fame, founded on honor's basis, fast, as the round earth to ages last. Some virtues vanish with our breath, virtue like this lives after death. Old time himself, his scythe thrown by, himself lost in eternity, an everlasting crown shall twine, to make a Wilkes and Sidney join. But should some slave-got villain dare, chains for his country to prepare, and, by his birth to slavery broke, make her, too, feel the galling yoke, may he be evermore accursed, amongst bad men be ranked the worst, may he be still himself, and still, go on in vice, and perfect ill, may his broad crimes each day increase, till he can't live, nor die in peace, may he be plunged so deep in shame, that Satan mayn't endure his name, and here, scarce crawling on the earth, his children curse him for their birth, may liberty, beyond the grave, ordain him to be still a slave, grant him what here he most requires, and damn him with his own desires. But should some villain, in support, and zeal for a despairing court, placing in craft his confidence, and making honor a pretense, to do a deed of deepest shame, whilst filthy lucre is his aim, should such a wretch, with sword or knife, contrive to practice against the life of one who, honored through the land, for freedom made a glorious stand, whose chief, perhaps his only crime, is, if plain truth at such a time, may dare her sentiments to tell, that he his country loves too well, may he but words are all too weak, the feelings of my heart to speak, may he owe for a noble curse, which might his very marrow pierce. The general contempt engage, and be the Martin of his age. Thanks for watching the channel. If you liked the video, please hit the like button. If you haven't already, please consider subscribing. Or if you would like to support the channel, please visit the link in the description to visit our Patreon page. Like the pictures in the video? Visit the link in the description to see more. Thanks again for watching.